Thanks a lot for having joined this webinar on semantic integration of marine data organized by the Horizon 2020 BlueBRIDGE project. We are very happy to have such a number of participants, so thanks again for joining. I am Sara Garavelli and I'm the outreach manager of the BlueBRIDGE project. A couple of words about BlueBRIDGE for those who are not familiar with it. BlueBRIDGE delivers tailor-made data management services to different communities, for example, aquaculture, ecosystem approach to fisheries, and other research sectors, and different stakeholders. More than 2,500 users from different sectors are currently exploiting the BlueBRIDGE services. The BlueBRIDGE services are operated through collaborative web-based research environments built on top of an hybrid data infrastructure. The BlueBRIDGE project started in September 2015, but its underlying infrastructure has been in place since 2006, so more than 10 years. Today's webinar explores one of the technological aspects investigated in the BlueBRIDGE project, which is the semantic integration of data. The format of the webinar is the following. 40 minutes are dedicated to the presentation of our speaker, and the last 20 minutes will be reserved for your questions. You can ask your questions by using the question panel that you can find on the right of your screen. We prefer to collect all the questions and address them at the end for the sake of time. After the webinar, the slides and the recording of the webinar will be made available on the BlueBRIDGE website. And in any case, we will send you an email with the links to all the material. If everything is clear, I'm going to introduce our speaker, Yannis Tzitzikas. First of all, thanks a lot, Yannis, for having accepted our invitation and for giving this talk. Yannis is currently Associate Professor of Information Systems in the Computer Science Department of the University of Crete and affiliated researcher of the Information Systems Laboratory at the Institute of Computer Science at Fort, the Foundation for Research and Technologies, ELLAS. Before joining the University of Crete and Fort, he was postdoctoral fellow at the University of Namur in Belgium, at the Italian National Council of Research, and at VTT, the Technical Research Center in Finland. In parallel, he was also a member of the Information Systems Lab of Fort ICS for about 8 years. Currently, his research focuses on exploratory searching, semantic data management, and methodologies and technologies for building advanced information systems for digital preservation. So I think I could speak for the full hour, as Yannis has an amazing CV, but I prefer to leave the floor to Yannis directly. So Yannis, if you are ready, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Sara. I would like to welcome everybody to this seminar. Thank you for your participation. I hope that you find this short seminar interesting. I will talk about semantic integration of marine data. Of course, it is not possible to describe everything in detail, but my objective is to communicate with you the vision and to share with you our experiences on semantic integration in the context of iMarine and BlueBRIDGE project. This is the outline of my talk. I will first motivate semantic integration to understand why we need it. I will then refer to difficulties and requirements. Then I will focus on marine data, that is the process, the techniques, the outcomes, the exploitation. And finally, I conclude and then we could discuss issues related to this presentation. I plan to use more or less 40 minutes. So, what is the motivation? Huge amounts of data are available, and we all know that this amount constantly increases. Almost all of us produce data, and everything will produce data in the next years. And at the same time, everyone needs data and will need data. However, what is the issue here? That data and information are not integrated. This is evident also in the non-digital world, in the sense that if we go in a library, we can see thousands of individual books. The situation is not much different in the digital world, because we all know that there are already hundreds or thousands of second catalogs, each one containing hundreds or thousands of datasets. So why this is not enough. Why having digital data sets, individual ones, is not adequate for our needs. The point is that in several domains and applications, we have to fetch and assemble information that comes from more than one data sets or sources. Why? To be able to answer complex queries. What kind of queries? Queries that are not answerable by the individual sources. So we would like to do this and be able to analyze the integrated data. This is of paramount importance for science, and especially for large-scale scientific questions, such as global warming, invasive species spread, and so on. And also true for several individual domains, from biodiversity, cultural domain, and government science in general. And this is also related with the current scientific paradigm, that is the data-intensive scientific discovery. So, what is the problem? The problem is that the semantic integration and integration of data is not easy. It has been reported that currently data scientists spend from 50 to 80% of their time for collecting and preparing data for being able to analyze them. So the situation in many cases like this, like this photo here. And what I mean with complex queries. Let me give you an example. Suppose you consider this species, Tunus albacares, and suppose that we would like to answer this question. We would like for this species to find ecosystems, water areas, and countries that this species is native to, and the common names that are used for this species in each of the countries, as well as their commercial codes. The key point is that there is not any data set currently as produced by the organizations that are involved in this domain that can be used to answer this, which is, from one perspective, is not that complex. And the situation is not, true only in the marine domain. In the cultural domain, consider that we are discussing about one painter, and we would like to get all paintings of El Greco referring to persons that were born between 0 and 300 before Christ. It's not possible to answer this kind of questions. But let's try to understand why integration is difficult, so why this is not an easy problem. First, data sets are kept or produced by different organizations in different formats, models, locations, and systems. The second difficulty is that the same real-world entities or relationships are referred with different names and in different natural languages. And we all know that natural languages have synonyms, homonyms, and so on. The third is that data sets usually contain complementary information. So sometimes, even if they conserve the same part of the reality, they do not have a lot of commonalities. Moreover, data sets can contain erroneous or even contradicting information. And also, the data sets, even if they conserve the same part of the reality, they may conceptualize it differently, making the integration hard. Let me give you some examples about these difficulties. First, about the names. Consider this species, Tunus albacares. Even this species has 348 common names in 82 different languages. So you understand that if you want to assemble information about this species, you have to tackle this problem. Or again, consider this term, Argentina. We all know the country, but probably not all of us know that there is one marine species with this name. A few words about the complementarity views. Sometimes the situation is like this. Several blind men inspect some part of the reality, and each one draws his own conclusions about the reality. And sometimes data sets are like the thoughts of this blind man. So we have to assemble all this in order to understand the reality and to understand that there is one elephant here. But even if they inspect the same part of the reality, they may conceptualize it differently. So you have to fill also this gap. So, what would be the list of general requirements or tasks which are needed in order to integrate information. Here I'm just listing the more basic tasks. The first, dataset discovery, to select the dataset, to be able to access and query, to fetch and transform data, to link the data, to clean them, to complete them through context or other information about the context of creation of or about the part of the reality that it concerns, to manage provenance, to measure the quality of the aggregated or integrated content, to manage and understand the evolution of datasets over time, to monitor the situation, to produce overviews, summarizations, to be able to explore the datasets, to summarize, to analyze, to preserve. So this is a list that more or less covers the entire life cycle, we could say. For reasons of time, I will mainly focus on some of these tasks: transformation, linking, cleaning, completion, provenance, and quality. So, what are the main approaches for integration? In general, we could say that there are two basic approaches. The first is the warehouse approach, or the materialized integration approach. The second is the mediator. In the first one, you have the individual data sets or sources, and mappings are used to extract, transform, and store this data in a single place, the warehouse, which is then used for query answering. Instead, in the mediator approach, you have the sources, the mediator does not store the data, but uses mappings in order to translate the queries that it receives to queries that are answerable by the sources, and then it returns back the answer. A few words about these two approaches. The warehouse approaches gives more flexibility in transformation logic, so you are free actually to transform the original data as you would like to do. The second and very important is you can have faster responses in query answering or in exploration. The third is that you are not adding extra load to the underlying sources if the constituent data sets are served by systems. And another one is that your integrated access does not depend on the underlying sources, whether they are up, running, fast, and so on. However, you have to pay the cost for hosting the warehouse and refreshing periodically its contents. In the mediator approach, the benefit, one advantage, but sometimes it can be a disadvantage, is that whenever something changes in one data set, this is directly reflected in the integrated, unified view of the data. So it seems that the higher complexity of such systems and the demands on the underlying sources can be justified only in case immediate access to updates is indeed needed. Otherwise, it is not a substantive solution. And of course, this is a general dichotomy in the sense that the warehouse can be considered as a cached version of the contents of the underlying sources. So, in general, there is more flexibility. Now, let me now focus on the marine data and especially marine species. This work has been started in the iMarine EU infrastructure project, and now it is continued in BlueBRIDGE project. So let me explain one situation related to semantic integration of data. Here we have information about marine species in several sources: worms, ecoscope, flood, fish-based Wikipedia. They actually store complementary information. Worms stores information, taxonomic information. Ecoscope about the ecosystem, which fish eats, which smaller fish. Flood is responsible for commercial codes. Fish base about occurrence data. Wikipedia contains general information and figures. They also provide access to this data through different technologies: web services, RDF dumps, spark-related points, relational databases, and so on. So now the question is, okay, even for these data sets, how to integrate them? The first question is, what's the scope of integration and how to control it? Because in principle, everything is connected. So for tackling this issue, we use the notion of competency query. What's a competency query? A query that is useful for the community and is not currently answerable by the individual datasets. So this is actually the requirements for the semantic integration. So in practice, what we have done is that we produce a list of competency queries and as they provided by the community, and this is actually the requirements for the integrated dataset. Now the second question is, should we materialize or should we mediate? The key point here is that in both cases, you need a sort of unified model or schema. Why? To be able to formulate the queries. And here is the spot where top-level ontologies enter the game. For this particular domain, we have designed MarineTLO, which is a global core model that offers fundamental classes and the relationships and the relations to enable knowledge sharing, information exchange, and integration between heterogeneous sources. It can host data described in different levels of detail. It allows data originating from distinct sources to be mapped to this ontology. It is not supposed to be a single ontology that covers everything, but the fundamental requirements. And the benefits of adopting one ontology is that you have reduced effort for constructing mappings, because instead of defining pairwise mappings between all sources, you just focus on mapping one source to the ontology, and also reduce effort for maintaining the warehouse in the sense that you can improve only that ontology and not individual schemas and so on. What are the requirements for these kind of ontologies? The query capabilities. It should be able, it should allow the formulation of what? Of the competency queries, which is the motivation for doing all this process. Currently, this ontology, we are in version 5, contains 115 classes and 85 property, and anyone can get it from the following address. So one parenthesis, at the end of my presentation, there are links that provide details about everything that I'm going to say in this seminar. So everything is open and there are publications for this. Now, let's return to the question, materialization or mediation. We will focus on the materialization case, so that is to how to construct a semantic warehouse that has as conceptual backbone the ontology MarineTLO. No, so now the question is, okay, what are the steps of this process for constructing such a warehouse? One important question that is technological is how to connect the fetched pieces of information. We adopt a semantic approach. And what's the key points of the semantic approach? That we use URIs instead of strings. Why? To be able to establish links between the datasets and also to avoid the problems of homonyms of natural language, as I mentioned at the beginning. But at the same time, you want to be able to express synonyms or equivalent identifiers. And this approach gives you the relations for establishing this kind of relations. And of course, it offers various other kinds of semantic relationships that are mainly useful for query interoperability. And this is actually the main motivation for the linked data publishing method that you may know. Now, let's return to the question, what are the steps for constructing a semantic warehouse? So now we could say, we could describe the steps in more detail. The first is to define the requirements in terms of competency queries. And these queries should be formulatable through the ontology that you have selected, designed, so on. Then you have to fetch the data from the selected data sets and produce here TRIBS means RDF tribbles, so pieces of information. You then transform and ingest them to the warehouse, and then you have to inspect the connectivity. Was these data sets were connected somehow? And then after this step, to formulate rules for creating more links between the data sets. So this ends up to rules for instance matching, which are then applied for producing same as triples, and then which are ingested to the warehouse, and then you have to test what you have done so far, how using the competency queries, which is the main motivation for doing this, and the connectivity metrics. And since everything changes over time, then you go back to the first step in the sense that you may have received a new requirement for the community, I'm interested also for this and this, and you go through again all the steps. So this is more or less the main steps for constructing and evolving the semantic warehouse. Here you can see some components that are used for these steps. And now I will say a few words about some of these steps in order to make clear the key points. In any case, as I mentioned, we need entity matching. And for doing this, both fully automatic methods and handcrafted rules are usually required. To give you an example, Tunus albacares, we can see here two URIs about the same species. The first comes from Wikipedia, the second from Ecoscope. Here, this is a simple case in the sense that we can see that there is a series of transformations that can produce the same string, and this can signify the equivalence of the URI. So this is a kind of a simple generic rule that can be applied for linking equivalent identifiers, URIs in this case. However, the situation is not that easy and fully automatic always, because here we can see two different URIs about the same species. Here is the URI from FAO. So we can see that the name Tunus albacares is not there. However, if we inspect the data set, we can see that here there's one label that gives the string. And also Ecoscope, there is one relationship that gives it here. So for this, for linking these pieces of data, you need a different rule that captures this characteristics. And then how to measure the quality of what you have done so far. Here is what we call connectivity assessment. But why this is useful? We need to assess how much the aggregated content is connected. We need to get an overview of the situation because the data set aggregated is a big one. You cannot do it by inspection by eye. You would like to quantify the value of the warehouse because it's important for query capabilities. If you have poor connectivity, this will affect negatively the query capabilities, which is the main requirement. So you need to be able to quantify this value. Another problem motivation for this is to make easier the monitoring, monitoring the warehouse easily after every reconstruction, because you do it periodically. You also would like to measure the contribution of each source. Why? Because you may decide in future to ignore some data sets and instead replace them by others. So you need a way to also measure the contribution of each source to the aggregated information. In general, connectivity has two main aspects, schema and distance. Schema refers to the capability, refers to whether the out data are described using the same schema elements. But if we adopt the approach that I'm presenting you, we have actually tackled this issue through the top-level ontology because we transform data according to Marine Taylor. However, you cannot bypass the instance connectivity problem. Okay, how to connect the data. Now, for making this, for controlling and assessing the connectivity, what we have done in this project is we have defined a series, a number of metrics. I will not go through all of them, just to give you the idea, that measure various commonalities that exist. I will just show you one metric, which is the increase in the average degree. The average degree of an entity roughly refers to what's the average number of attributes, of properties, for the entities of interest. And what we can see in this slide is that the average degree of the entities was 18. So 18 attributes is the average number of attributes for the entities in these sources. However, these entities in the warehouse have an average degree of 72. So this is a concrete way to quantify the value and the benefit of the semantic warehouse, that you have more complete information. Another important perspective is provenance. What we have realized for doing these tasks in the context of this project is that you need to support provenance at various levels. At the conceptual level, at the URIs and values level, at triple level, and at the query level. Conceptual modeling level. Sometimes, if for the information you need to model the provenance of some data, because this is required also from the queries. In our case, the provenance of species names is important. So here you can see that the marine TLO ontology offers you the relations and concepts for modeling how one particular identifier, what's the origin of this identifier. We know this is from fowl and this is from worms. So this is sometimes you need to model provenance at that level, at the conceptual modeling level. Sometimes you would like to keep track of the origin of the data by exploiting the namespace mechanism of URIs and the natural language annotations of literals. So from the namespace of a URI, you get an idea about how this data has from where it was retrieved. And this can be done also for literals. However, the more useful way to manage provenance is triple-level provenance, that is to be able to keep separately the information that you have extracted, transforming from every individual source. So actually, you use separate graph spaces, and this not only provides you complete information, but also you can refresh only some parts of the warehouse if you have structured your data in this way. And finally, how you exploit the provenance. Of course, you can exploit it by making queries that have criteria that are evaluated based on the provenance formation, but also some general performance facilities, like some query rewritings that we offer. For instance, consider this query. For a scientific name of a species, find the file codes of the water areas in which this species is native. If you would like to formulate this in SparkQL, which is the query language, the Semantic Web, you will do it like this. You see the query. So what we also offer is an automatic query rewriting that extends this query with some other variables, and in this way the user or the applications that exploit this warehouse can get information about what sources have contributed for each particular row of the answer. Now, all these steps that I described are carried out by Matware, which is a suite of tools. It contains several components. I will not describe it in detail. I'm just mentioning that this is done using a suite of tools that we have developed that includes also external tools and so on. Now, eventually, the warehouse contains information about every entity. Here we can see about this crucial vacares in this way, in a graph structure, and we can see how there is information from different sources about this particular entity. Here we just see some main concepts that are covered by this semantic warehouse and how the sources and the data sets have contributed to this. I mentioned earlier that monitoring is important because you refresh it periodically. So you need an easy way to understand that if everything is okay, nothing crucial was changed in the individual data sets. So what we actually do is that we inspect these connectivity metrics over time from version to version. And this gives you, with a glance, an idea of what's going on. Another example of a semantic warehouse is GRSF, the Global Record of Stocks and Fisheries. Fisheries, an activity leading to the harvesting of fish within the boundaries of well-defined area. While stock is a group of individuals of a species or occurring in a well-defined special range. Okay, so the idea is that we would like to build a single knowledge base with the aid of FAO for monitoring and managing all stocks and fisheries worldwide, something that does not exist currently. The process is more or less the same. Here the data sets are different. We fetch, transform, dissect, merge. The only difference is that here the communities involved in the search to validate the aggregated content, and also SICAN catalogs are used for supporting this process, and then the end product is published and the users can exploit it. Here just an overview of the current contents of GRSF. I should mention that a webinar for this particular knowledge base is scheduled for I think December or February. So the community will have the opportunity to learn more about this topic. Now, what about exploitation? Well, I have described the main steps, the motivation, the requirements, the challenges, and the steps for constructing a semantic warehouse. I should say a few words about how different methods for exploiting this. Of course, there are several. I will just mention some of these, of the tasks that we have carried out, we have developed in the context of this project. The first is, here is just a list, but I will describe each one. It's better like this. One approach is to exploit it for semantically processing the search results. So what's the idea? You use a search system, even a web search engine, external. And then you can exploit the warehouse. Why? To perform entity mining at that time. So to identify the entities of interest, to analyze them, to group them, rank them, and then to provide the user with a more rich structure for interacting and exploring the search results. To give you an idea, this is a screenshot of a system. At the middle part, we can see the search results returned by that system, which is external, so we are not we cannot do anything with that. And here you can see the result of entity mining. So the hits have been analyzed at query time. And here we see the entities that have been identified, organized by various categories. So the user can focus on one part of the answer and locate hits that would be very low ranked and so on. So this is how the semantic warehouse can enrich even external search services. And of course, the user can get more information about the identified entities. And here is one card that shows information to the user about this particular species if the user clicks on that. The user could also explore the semantic warehouse even in web browsing. Over any web page, you can add to your browser a bookmarklet that sends a request to one of the services that explores the warehouse and marks, annotates automatically the web page that you are viewing in your browser. A second category of application is the classical web applications. You build one application, a fact sheet generator, or a mobile application that provides information to the user about something. And in this way, you explore the semantic warehouse just as if it were a database, but a more rich and complete source of information. A third category of application is based on semantic views. I will explain you the idea. You have a semantic warehouse that has information about all this information integrated, but then you may realize that you would like to support some tasks and not all this information is required. So what actually you do, you define a semantic view, you extract only the information that your task needs, and then you can feed a different tool with the results of with the answer of these views. One example of this process is species identification. And the idea is that you extract some information that is useful about marine species for the task of species identification, and then you give to the users a way to explore this subset. And here mainly with preference and rich faceted search. And here you can see this application. The user has several facets. He can open, restrict the focus or express preferences. And this way you support a flexible process for species identification. So this is a different kind of exploitation of a semantic warehouse, and you can do it as many times as you want. So you define one view, one query, and then you exploit the results. Here is some screenshots from the exploitation of GRSF, the Global Record of Stocks and Fisheries. Here the user can search for products, he can get complete information about a stock record. Here, just see only some of this information, and so on. Finally, and for aiding the curator of this aggregated or integrated data set, we have also designed some 3D visualizations of the connectivity metrics in order to make easier the monitoring and inspection of the data sets. Here we can see easily how much content was contributed by each data set and the connections that exist between this. Now, a few words now about some earlier steps of the process, that is for data set discovery. Data set discovery is very important because first you have to find what data sets are there for semantically integrating them, if you would like to. So in order to support this, currently in BlueBRIDGE, we are trying to semantically enrich the data catalog facilities in order to make this more flexible and easy. In what sense? To enable complex queries, like search for data sets containing information about Sparse Aurata, published by iMarine organization within 2016-17. So we would like to also offer more flexible methods to discover data sets, and then find them, and then decide if you would like to semantically integrate them. Now, what I would like to stress is that the approach that I described to you is general, it's not very domain specific. In what sense? That we could, instead of doing salvacares, we could have a painter. And even in that case, there are several data sets and sources that provide information, but we would like to be able to integrate all this information. If we would like to say, okay, what is the big picture regarding semantic integration and the required conceptual modeling, we could say that we can identify three main perspectives. One is the core conceptualization of earth sciences. The second is human activities, and the third one is products of human activities. So in the first one, the core conceptualization of earth sciences, we can have collections of samples or specimen of species, and these are taken for complex systems that have a time and spatial perspective. We have human activities that roughly are observations in a situation of a complex system or simulation. And we have also products, the products of these activities, which is forecasts, records, databases, publication, indexes. And the key point is that the semantic approach is capable of connecting all this in a meaningful way for fostering discoverability, data sharing, and interoperability. Some of you may have the question, okay, are all knowledge bases have the same characteristics or the same role in the in our activities? I could say that we can make some distinctions according to two criteria. The first is the scope. We may have some knowledge bases about one particular domain or for a wide or cross domain. And the second criteria is about conceptual modeling. Is the conceptual modeling a simple or is it adequate for scientific needs, for the needs of integration or assimilation of knowledge? So, well-known and successful knowledge bases like TPP, VIA, GoFall in this area. So they are cross-domain, but their structure is simple. So they are not capable, are not sufficient for to be used in a scientific and research context. We have some here also for particular domains, as we can see here. And here is where marine TLO, GRSF falls. We have the marine domain, not for the wide domain about everything. And we have a structure that's appropriate for integration. And of course, the vision, the community vision, is to reach this area over there. So to be able to cover almost everything in a way that can foster science. To conclude, semantic integration, according to my opinion, could boost data-intensive scientific discovery. It requires tackling several challenging issues. In this presentation, I have tried to communicate with you the main difficulties, the requirements, the challenges. And I presented you a process and a few words about the tools that we have developed for supporting this process in the marine domain. Some keywords is scope control, how to control what you would like to do, ontological modeling, connectivity assessment, provenance, reconstructability, accessibility. Currently, and thus as regards our research efforts, we are trying to come up with processes that can be applied to large number of data sets, okay? Because the vision is to be able to cover a wide domain. And this is important for assembling the puzzle of data sets and exploiting, therefore, better the information than the data that we already have. So this is more or less what I would like to say. Here at the end of my presentation, I have some pointers to tools that were mentioned in my presentation, malware for automating the warehouse construction process, top-level ontologies, links to particular warehouses, research prototypes and services that semantically annotate the results, tools that exploit the warehouse for identifying entities and explore the warehouses, tools for exploratory search like the one that I showed you for species identification, the GRSF virtual research environment, and here some research prototypes about interactive 3D visualization of the log cloud, and here an index for measuring the commonalities of large number of data sets. Of course, this is a joint work with my colleagues, mainly with Yannis Marketakis, Nikos Minatakis, and Michalis. So I would like to thank you for your participation, your attention, and feel free to make the questions. I would like to say that the presentation will be publicly accessible after this webinar. I hope also a recording. And also, in case you have questions at a later point in time, you could also communicate with me by mail. So thank you.
I wanted to thank you, Yannis, for on behalf of all the participants for your very clear presentation. We do have a question, I see, and the question is the following. Someone is asking if these ideas that you presented are also harmonized with the Inspire Directive in terms of data models, libraries, and code lists.
Yes, we are supporting all this, and although I did not present the details, we also exploit and consider the formats that the communities have already developed and used for recording and exchanging information. And in the context of BlueBRIDGE, we have built all these transformation tools for transforming and extracting information from these established formats and transforming this data into semantic data.
Okay. So I'm asking all the other participants if they have any other question, so we can maybe wait a couple of minutes. Please post your question in the question panel on the right that you see on GoToWebinar. In the meantime, Yannis, would you like to, I don't know, remark anything or add anything to your presentation?
What I would like could stress is that this is, according to me, a very challenging task that can be, that is at the same time very, very useful. There are already so many data sets, and it's a wealth of data, but we underexploit it currently. Another point is that I could mention is that once you do this that I have described, then you mainly press one button and you refresh the entire warehouse. So you have to dedicate some time to select the ontology and some transformations, but then you have it for the future. So you don't have a lot of, you don't need a lot of time for maintaining it. So if the community starts to agree on some conceptual models like marine PLO and so on, then all these tasks will be made much more easy, and semantic integration will require much less time. Now, as regards the the support of the long-term vision, I could say a few words, that what we currently do is to try to see how we could aid a humans curator to integrate hundreds of data sets. So for doing this, you need some indexes in order to help you to identify the commonalities and so on. So what we actually do in this research direction stems from the requirements of this project is to build this kind of indexes to provide some cross data set inference services to aid this task, and for making this scalable also in terms of performance, we are exploiting, we have ported these techniques for a cluster environment. So you can exploit several machines for carry out the required computation and index construction fast. So these are two remarks.
There is another question, Yannis. Is there a specific mechanism to check data quality?
Data quality, this is a good question, as I said. I mentioned in my presentation that for testing data quality, first you use the competency queries. So you have one query. It's just like it resembles software testing. So you make one JUnit test. You want this query, and you certainly would like to have in the answer this and this, and certainly not that. So this is the first domain-specific way of testing. The other task is through the connectivity metrics. So if you inspect a low connectivity, that means that something has gone wrong, or you haven't modeled the information in a way that is automatically connected. However, I would like to mention that this process for semantically integrated dataset has provided us with a method to spot errors in the datasets that we have used. Because you collect in one place information about one marine species and so on, so you see the differences. And our objective here is not to make one approach, let's take the average of this attribute, but since it is used for scientific purposes, so we have higher demands as regards quality, we communicate with the datasets for fixing the errors. But indeed, in the general picture, quality is very, very, very important.
Okay, thanks. We have another question. Is it expensive to update the meaning of a data triple in a warehouse?
Expensive to update the?
Update the meaning of a data triple in a warehouse.
The meaning. In order to avoid this question, that is to collect data and then not having a clear way to interpret it, the process that I described starts differently. Okay, let's first construct a conceptual model about how we would like to view the world. What is the meaning that we would like to give? And then you use the data for populating this schema. So in this way, you don't actually have the problem of having data that you cannot interpret, because somehow you control what the transformations of the data. I don't know if that was...
Okay, I think it was quite clear. And we do have another question. How do you handle disagreements between data sources?
Disagreements along data sources, as I mentioned before, we have spotted several such situations. The first is because the data sets comes for organizations that are responsible for these data sets. So it's not data sets that we found somewhere and we try to exploit them somehow. So this is one task. The second is, the technical one is that, as I mentioned, that provenance is important. We do not take, because it's not our role to make one decision that this is correct or the other is correct. So in the semantic warehouse, we have different graph spaces, each containing the information by one source or data set. So we host the conflicting information that we have. So it is up to the exploitation of the warehouse, of the one that writes the queries, whether he would like to take all information about this attribute value, to take the average, the mean, the less. So it's up to the exploitation. We are not making one such decision because we are not responsible for correcting the data.
Now we have a very interesting question. So how can the wider community help further building the marine TLO for other social and economic domains?
Yes, as I have mentioned, marine TLO is one ontology that is based on some well-funded, some basic conceptual modeling principles. And actually, we could say that the conceptual backbone in sciences is more or less the same, the conceptual backbone. To be more specific, for the cultural domain, and this is why I mentioned this, there is one other ontology, and also in marine TLO exploits some of the classes and the relations of that ontology that is called SIDOC-CRM. SIDOC-CRM is an ISO standard for the cultural domain for exchange information about cultural goods, and this is actually in the map that I showed, here you can see British Museum. British Museum uses SIDOC-CRM as the ontology for documenting all this stuff. So the idea is that the community has already decided, we have tested this, we have communities that have agreed that they can, there is some core conceptual model that they agree and they can use it for data sharing and exchange. So, that means that the same process can be exploited for other domains. You mentioned sociological domains and so on. And BlueBRIDGE, the infrastructure, and our lab have expertise on this and applying this approach in different domains. So the answer is, and always it starts, as I mentioned in one slide, what are the queries that you would like to answer that you cannot answer? So you list the queries. From the queries, you decide how is the conceptual model, and then you carry out the next steps.
Okay, I think that this is also partially replies to this other question. Is there any chance to include the EU nomen, the Pan-European Species Directories infrastructure, to support inspire species mapping?
Yes, we could. I don't know exactly the details of what you mentioned, but we, as partners, as projects, we would like to include the more data sets, the better, because each data set gives us information. There is this information that could be useful. Does this require a new class or relations in the ontology, and so on? And as I said, the process is modular, so you map one data set to the ontology. So it does not affect the rest. So in principle, yes, and we would like to be able to do it. And if someone has some particular suggestions, you can communicate with the project, with us, and so on.
Okay, thank you so much, Yannis. I think that we don't have any other questions, but as Yannis said, if you have further questions that you want to ask Yannis, so you can do that after the webinar. So we will make available an email address that you can contact. And thanks again, Yannis, for your time and for your clarity. I think that everybody enjoyed your webinar. And would you like to say something before closing?
No, actually, I would like to thank everyone. I hope you find something useful for this presentation. You didn't see me. I didn't see you. I hope we communicated through slides and through the talk. And feel free to communicate with me with any about any question or idea, or to exploit something of this in a different context and so on. And I should also say that this is one part of tools and services in the BlueBRIDGE infrastructure. I focused on this particular task. The infrastructure supports several other services for hosting, computational power, analytics, and so on. So this was a focused application presentation on this part, but of course this is one part of a bigger infrastructure.
Okay, thanks again, Yannis. I think we can close this webinar. Thanks to the participants. And let's meet you all to the upcoming WebRidge webinar that will be in September. And the focus of the next webinar will be on performance evaluation and benchmarking in aquaculture. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. Have a nice day.
Bye. Bye-bye.